Good afternoon. It's a pleasure to be here. As you might know, I'm coming from Russia, and I'm staying for today and tomorrow. And it is indeed a pleasure to be back to a COP. And I was told by my colleagues that we are still not there yet, but we are making a lot of effort. It is natural because it's only Thursday. Being only Thursday, we do have some hours left today, tomorrow. I don't have much to add at this point in time. I arrived not long ago, so I am still learning the details of the negotiation with the help of my colleagues. So if you have specifics on the negotiations, I would pass the ball to my colleagues. Otherwise, I would be more than happy to answer your questions. Thank you.
Lisa, please.
Thanks, Lisa Friedman from ClimateWire. Interesting to see you. Can you tell me if Brazil supports Saudi Arabia's demand for oil reparations before moving forward on 2015 discussions toward the 2015 deal?
No, we have. I don't know how far you have discussed that.
Very, very minor.
But we don't have that position. It's not the position of our government. But we would be willing to discuss any issue as we do always with other parties to the convention, and we are open to conversation. But again, this is not our position, and you will not see my country going to that direction.
Next question. Lady here in front, please.
Sophie from RTCC. How far are loss and damage negotiations from being settled now?
Well, loss and damage is a very important issue. It's a very important issue that must be part of the outcome in 2015, certainly part of the new deal. We hope to make progress fast in this area, and we don't see that as detrimental to the whole issue of adaptation. Some say that, well, if you go for loss and damage, it is because you feel that adaptation will not be there, or even that the fight against climate change will not be there, so you will have damage, and then you need a mechanism for loss and damage. I understand those that don't like this line of thinking, because it is as if we all collectively think that nothing that we are doing will result in controlling climate change. I don't feel like that. I feel that, yes, we must do, and we must go further. We have to have ambition. We have to work hard in terms of mitigation. We have also to work hard in terms of adaptation, but yes, we need and we would like to support fellow developing countries in that question of loss and damage.
next question? Lady here in front, please.
Fiona Harvey from The Guardian. Thank you. I wanted to ask about the ADP, because there's some discussion over the, you know, whether we should have a clear timetable coming out of this. Some people have said that if we don't have a clear timetable, then there will, you know, these talks will have been pointless. But what's your position on that?
I think a timetable is very important, but I also think that ambition is important. I would not like to have a timetable that would mean a very weak ambition. You see my point. I don't mind a timetable. I think a timetable is important, right? But I don't think that I don't want that by setting a timetable you go for weaker ambition. I don't know if you could add to that.
Thank you. That's exactly the point that the minister made. We are looking at that. I mean, we need to get to the agreement. Number one, the dates are there, 2015. We need to, there will be a time when which we need to put, all countries need to put numbers on. And let us just not forget that this is not only a mitigation agreement. It, as the minister mentioned, it covers all other areas: adaptation, finance, transfer science and tech, and capacity building. But we need to be to work for, to foster ambition, not necessarily to go through the motion and putting some useless numbers that will not be effective, because that's the other issue that we look for in this agreement, the position that Brazil is putting forward. We want this to be an effective agreement and a fair agreement and a comprehensive agreement, so and on a balanced manner. So if you added all this up, if you blended, put it in a blender, we need to arrive at a date which most suitable for ambition.
Next question. Lady here in front.
Thank you. I'm Maria Cleroux. I'm with AFP, the French news agency. If I may ask the ambassador, please, I would like to get a bit more of a sense of where we are with only one day left to go. Is there a lot of behind-the-scenes talks going on to try and, you know, get some sort of an outcome, and on what? Do you think there will be an overnighter tonight?
Thank you. Not behind the scenes. We meet in the halls, we meet in the cafes, we meet everywhere. But the important thing is that we've been pushing for a transparent for transparent deliberations. And so far, we must recognize that the presidency and the co-chairs of ADP are really playing in a fair, transparent way. That's commendable, and we should all recognize that. The other thing is that we still got, as the minister said, we still got a day and a half, a day and some hours to go, and we are hopeful that yes, we will have. But let us be mindful that that this is a period in which this is midway in the ADP process, and we need to look at we are hopeful that we shall have an understanding on countries going back home and preparing themselves for the negotiations. That's number one. And it shows, and this is a proposal that Brazil put on the table, that for all of us to be working for that goal. That's number one. Number two, that we should have a very clear timetable for the meetings and the negotiations for the next COP in Lima and for the upcoming work in Paris in 2 years. And the third issue that we should all be concerned, and this is the thing that is somehow disheartening for the Brazilian delegation and the developing countries, we have not seen the sense of urgency. We have not seen the importance importance of actions to be taken prior to 2020. This is an issue Brazil is strongly pushing, and we hope that in the 24 hours that we have left to go, that we'll achieve that.
Next question. I see you, Alex, please.
Thanks very much, Alex Morales, Bloomberg News. My question to the minister, is what we're seeing here in Warsaw commensurate with what needs to be done to achieve the 2-degree goal?
Well, frankly, as I said, I just arrived and I'm not trying to dodge your question. But I have just arrived. I still need to be briefed about everything that is going on. But what I can tell you is that, yes, we need to have this sense of urgency. It is understandable that some issues will not be solved now. They will be worked on for the next 2 years, both in Lima and in Paris, and on the way to Lima and Paris. And we need to, as my colleague said, we need to have a clear timetable of next steps so that we have next steps commensurate to the urgency of the problem. You put it on the 2 degrees thing, and hopefully less than 2 degrees. 2 degrees is something that many feel is not tolerable. So hopefully it will be less than that, and that's what we are working for. Thank you.
Next. I see you, lady.
Thank you. Nina Chesney from Reuters. Ambassador Carvalho, you mentioned the need to arrive at the date which is most suitable for ambition. Would that be after the US presidential elections next year, in November?
All of us, many of us, fortunately, have elections. So this cannot be a process that is tailor-made for to accommodate only one country. There are more than 200 countries at the UN, and we need to work with all of them. That's an important thing. But this is an important issue that we need to be mindful of particular circumstances, both in the country that you alluded to, but also in other countries. Yes, we need to be wise enough to construct an agenda and to construct a road ahead of us for a successful meeting in Paris, taking into account the interests of all.
Any more questions? You lady in red, please.
Laurence Caramel from Le Monde, a French daily. The NGOs decided not to stay in the COP to protest against the lack of progress. Could you comment this decision?
Well, I cannot comment on a decision by the NGOs. We work very well with them, and we value their presence in the COPs. If they did so, they must have had reason to do that. I cannot judge that. The only thing I can say is that we definitely like to work with them, and we hope they will continue to be present in that process that we have ahead of us from now to 2015.
Next question over here, please.
Matthew Carr from Bloomberg News. I guess for both gentlemen, There was a question yesterday about the leverage that developing countries have in these talks, and while you may not be the richest countries now, your burgeoning middle classes will mean that you are potentially at least the richest countries quite soon. Now the US and Europe, they want to sell to those middle classes. Why don't you use that leverage to encourage them to pay into the Green Climate Fund, maybe do a little bit more for loss and damage? They could pay less now, and then in the future you might tax their goods a little less. Thanks.
Well, let me, and if you may add something later, but let me comment on that. A part of the final deal certainly has to be the question of financing. And I'm not saying that this financing will benefit particularly my country. What I'm saying is that developing countries will need financing both for mitigation and adaptation, but also new technologies, greener technologies, capacity building, a number of important issues in dealing with climate change. So definitely the fact that countries have a responsibility on the creation of a problem implies that they have also a responsibility in addressing the problem, both from the viewpoint of their own action in terms of mitigation, but also in helping others to help them addressing the problem that they have created.
The developing countries, that's to go head on your question, have been put forward, endorsed, embraced the Brazilian proposal on a science-based study for a methodology to be drawn by the IPCC for countries to be able to ascertain what is the responsibility that the minister was alluding to. So this, unfortunately, has been rejected. Is that a leverage that we have? What we're looking at is at I hate to repeat what I said. I wonder whether you were here before. But we're looking for an effective and fair agreement, science-based agreement. We might politics might do a lot, but politics will never take science out of the picture.
Next question. To Carl here in front, please.
Thank you. For the minister, did I understand correctly that Brazil does not want to see a timeline for offers in the Warsaw decision? Okay. And when do you think would be a good time to put forth targets?
It is not possible for me to judge that at this point in time. The only thing that we feel, and we have said that, is that it is important to have a timeline, yes. But we have to be flexible enough not to set artificial dates. We have to look for a right time to do that, a time that may maximize the level of ambition. That's what we are talking about. Let's not simply set a date and what if this date is the worst possible moment for having a very high level of ambition? That's our point. We are not against that, on the contrary. We're in favor. But on top of being in favor, we are in favor of having it at the best suitable time. That's it.
Any more questions?
I see the lady over there in the back, please.
Thanks. Valerie Flynn, ENDS Europe. And some of the developed country negotiators have suggested that some of the like-minded countries, including Brazil, are maybe trying to emphasize the areas of difference between developed and developing countries to try and maybe hold the talks back and prevent the talks from moving to a place where emerging economies would have to make concrete mitigation commitments. Would you like to respond to that and maybe tell us some of the ways that Brazil is trying to find agreement with developed countries? Thanks.
A few things need to be clear. We are all committed in this agreement. But we are all committed in this agreement to work on, as the ADP has mentioned, has agreed a few years back. We are going to work on the basis, the principles of the convention. So this exercise that will lead us to the new agreement applicable to all is not to rewrite the convention. That's number one issue. But the most important issue, I think, for us to be clear, is that we did not come here to start a blame game. We came here to advance, to make progress, to allow us to be in a situation in which, after the hard work that we have to undertake from here to Lima, and the hard work that we'll have to take from Lima to Paris, we expect that this will result in an effective, ambitious, and fair, and balanced agreement. We're not here to blame, we're not here to finger point, we were here to work. We came prepared to start working and advancing, not to rewrite the convention, but to follow the ADP process mandate.
Next, I see the gentleman in the back over there, please.
Markus Becker from Der Spiegel in Germany. This is for the minister. It's about the loss and damage negotiations which have just produced a new draft document. And as far as I understand it, in this document almost none of the most important requirements of the developing nations has been met. So my question would be, are you happy with the developments right now in this track, and what would be your minimal requirements to come out of these negotiations?
Again, I am really sorry for the fact that I just came here. I don't know the new text. What I know is what I said, that we are in favor of having a loss and damage system. We think it is important that this will address the immediate needs for those who were hit by the consequences of climate change. And on top of that, we need financing for adaptation and mitigation in developing countries. One thing does not exclude the other. They are all important. They are all part of the fight against climate change. And we certainly need a robust outcome in terms of loss and damage. Thank you.
I see the gentleman in blue here in front, please.
Hi, David Jolly from the New York Times. I've been hearing that in the discussions right now on the ADP, on the main text that people would talk about for mitigation of climate change in the future, that there is a kind of a, what the French would call an opération escargot, a sort of a go-slow movement, and led partly by Brazil. And I wondered, if you leave here without any concrete agreement on when you're going to make your commitments, is, can you even call this a meeting a step forward at all? And this person said, they're such good diplomats that they delay without looking like they're delaying. You're speaking of you guys.
I don't know who you are talking to. What I do know is that this country was never accused of doing that, and I take issue on this. This country, my country, has been in the forefront of the negotiations. We are here to make progress. We are not doing any Operation Escargot. So my hope is that you go back to the room and see what we are doing.
We have time for one last question. Let's see you, Lisa, here in front, please.
Thanks for second bite. Can you explain what you mean when, you know, when you say that applicable to all doesn't mean rewriting the convention? What, like in real language, what does that mean? The U.S. has said, you know, different countries do different things, but they do them unilaterally. They do them on the same legal footing. Under your, you know, do you take it to mean that nothing's changed? Countries, no. Developing countries only do things voluntarily when there's financing, or is there any change that you agreed to 2 years ago in Durban?
Now, what we did agree in Durban is a plain English text that says, and it's nothing strange in that text. That text said of a new instrument applicable to all. That would be under the convention, meaning it would be done under the rules of the convention and the principles of the convention, and that's very clear. That's plain English. Applicable to all, yes. Applicable to all because it will be binding to everybody. The answer that is not in that text, and that's why we are negotiating, is that how the obligations of countries will be under this new text. Meaning, you may have different kinds of obligations for different countries or different groups of countries. You might use criteria for determining what kind of obligations a country will have. For instance, some countries may have the obligation of financing, of providing financing, while others may not have that obligation. It will be binding on everybody, but the obligations might be different. So that's what remains, and that's not a small task. What remains to be determined through the negotiations, what will be the obligations of different countries or different groups, but the new instrument will be binding on everybody.
Thank you all.